just going to keep rotating, applying the flame point a little bit closer to the paint, between the paint and the nut. Because basically the heat needs to be going into the nut. You may have actually used blue, but generally they use red. So that's coming loose. You can see that sucker's... And it's going to be hot. I'm just reminding you of the obvious, so... And you can, you know, be careful of the paint. You're just trying to... I think the shop air is actually pretty... Yeah, there's not a lot of it now, but I didn't turn on the compressor yet. So. Hot potato, hot potato. So there's your nut. Okay. There's your 5 millimeter wrench, and you should just be able to. With some, you might need to use a little bit of initial torque. There it goes. So now you're going clockwise because you're basically unthreading the strut housing from the other side. And I'm supporting it. I'm going to zoom out a little bit. So I'm supporting this end. The dust boot's on here. It's probably a good idea just to leave it on the dust boot, just so that you're grabbing around that. You're not going to be marring anything. Assuming that you have one, most of the new Bilstein struts do tend to come with this boot. So there you go. So this is now coming free. There is, I would do your best to keep this kind of straight as it's coming out, because there are the linear bushings that guide it. So I'm pretty careful as I pull this out this end. So here is your strut insert. There's the top end that attaches to the strut, upper strut mount or your camber plate. This is the provided locked, nylon nut at the end. Here's your dust boot. In some cases, there'll be an external bump stop, but most of the time it's good. So here's your M10 by 1.0 threads on the bottom end here. And here's your bump stop. So that is the sucker that you end up riding around on that is inside here. It's essentially resting in here, and your strut is, your monotube shock is moving obviously in and out. The shock shaft is staying constant because it's attached right here to the bottom of the strut housing. And then again, this is the bearing surface. This 36 millimeter, well, it's actually more like 39 or 40 millimeter chromed region is what is providing the bearing surface inside the strut insert over here, the strut housing. So this is now your exposed Bilstein internal bump stop, strut bump stop. I believe this is about 65 millimeters. 65 millimeters, okay. Yay for memory, 65 millimeters long. What we generally do when we're looking to get the most compression travel and also make sure we're protecting the suspension and suspension members in the chassis at full bottoming is the ideal would be to actually reinstall everything. The strut housing, strut insert, and the bump stop, maybe cutting it down so you keep just this initial section without the spring, and then do a travel measurement where you're compressing it with the tire on the car, also first without tire, and then second with the tire. And then you can see how much room you may have from, say, the first uncut bump stop, put it in with that, compress it, see how much room there is above the tire, between the tire and the fender liner, between the tire and any potential contact points. You want to turn the wheel, make sure that both opposite, both ends of lock, there's no contact. This is really important for modified cars where you have wider tires and even off, different offset wheels, wider wheels. And generally what I found is that you can take off this back section and then you can retain this initial section, which has a little bit of a taper on it. If you look at the inside of this, there's a little bit of a taper there, so it's slightly linear. It's not too bad. So let me just get it greasy. That's about 30 millimeters to the middle of this grooved area right there. So I believe in most cases we go to about that 30, and then we add a 3 millimeter packer, sometimes a 6, but usually I think a 3 is generally adequate. A general mnemonic that I found is that if a bump stop is say a soft density. 100 pounds per inch, relatively speaking. This is, I believe, closer to a 200 pound. But if you have a 100 pound per inch bump stop, that's say 30 millimeters long. in this case, say 65. Okay, so let's just go to this example. 200 pound per inch bump stop, 65 millimeters. The fully compressed height of it would be about 35 to 40% of the initial height. It might actually be a little bit shorter. So you'd get down to probably about 20, 30, 40%, about 20 to 25 millimeters or so at full height. So it would be a little bit shorter than this section at full compression. That would be my estimate based on just the density and how the 200 pounder works. If we switch to a 100 pound bump stop, so like a 46 millimeter, we call linear bump stop, or if we take a 58 millimeter or 76 millimeter red, which is also 100 pounds per inch, and if we slice that down to about, 25 millimeters, then that now is about 30% packing fraction, effectively, or it's the height at full compression would be about 30% of the initial height of the bump stop. So that would end up being about 15, so we got 30 millimeters times 30%, so about 10 millimeters or so, 10 to 12 millimeters. So it would be a good bit shorter, it would be somewhere like around that. So I definitely encourage people to, if you're going to do this on your own, to be careful with how short you get with the bump stop. I think and also make sure you use packers behind it, because the packer is great. You only have a solid material there, and I'll just show you what a packer looks like. This is a 3 millimeter slotted packer, and this is a 3 millimeter unslotted, just a solid packer. So the packer is essentially adding a certain amount of protection. It's effectively making the shock body, you could call it, longer. The body's over here, making it a little bit longer so that you have protection at full compression if there's some potential metal contact someplace else in the system. So say 10 millimeters of a 100 pound bump stop would be equivalent to 3 millimeters of hard packer, more or less. It'd be less if you had a 200 pound. So we have definitely found improvements with suspension travel. I did this with the front of the BMW struts, the same, we're using Bilstein struts in the Beamer as well, struts and shocks in the rear. And that bump stop's also internal to the housing, so I just made my best guess. I did some measurements and I said, okay, it looks like about 25 millimeters of, I believe I'm using this density bump stop, but I actually might switch to a 46 white, or 46 red, instead of what here is essentially a white. So this is a 200 pound bump stop. And so you also will get more understeer using a higher density front bump stop than switching to a softer density. So if you go from a Bilstein bump stop to a 46 millimeter that you can trim, or to keep it really linear, to like a 76 millimeter red or 58 millimeter red, and then you trim those to 25 to 30 millimeters, you're going to get more travel, more linear engagement, really reduce your understeer, and then you want to use your packers to make sure that you've protected the suspension at full compression, which would only happen if you hit a mid-corner bump, or if you went over a big bump, or you had something on the street happening. But you want to make sure your suspension is working at those limits, not only the ideal context of being on an autocross course. So there you go. Hopefully this is helpful. I've been really needing to do this for quite a while.